goes right through. Puts on the slip again. Hard goes, Freddy. That was magnificent stuff.
Welcome back to the Advantage Line Punters, and it is a very special podcast. Origin 1 is around the corner, and what better way to celebrate Origin than to not only have the great Matthew Fisk, the incomparable Paul Mawadi, but the one and only Blake Ayshford in studio. Welcome, boys.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello from Wellington.
Huge. It's going to be huge.
It's, I don't know everyone's first memories of Origin. Perhaps we'll go to that, but I recall, my first memories of Origin are Darryl Eastlake. Yeah, Hugh Darryl Eastlake in the commentary box, those late 80s games, watching Queensland roundly hammer the Blues. Yeah, it was, I didn't realise that would be most of my adulthood as well. But in those days, it was, Wally Lewis and Gene Miles just, thumping a Blues team that perennially changed their halves, played people out of position, played back rowers at prop. Some things don't change. It's all the same still 25 years later, but here we are. Fisky, your first memory of Origin.
Actually, yeah, I've got a really good one. I went to the SCG. Might have been that one, that wet game in, say, 85, roughly then, or 84. Or
the Greg Dowling try.
Yeah, it might have been that one. And I was 8 years old, and the crowd started chanting, "Wally's a wanker." And I looked up at Dad, and, we weren't allowed to swear at home. And Dad said, "Son, you're allowed to swear tonight." And that was the greatest moment when I'm there singing "Wally's a wanker" for the whole match. Even when everyone stopped, I just kept going. And according to Wally's wife, he still is a wanker. So
what about you? What
about the moment? But it's a great memory.
What about you, Paul?
I guess it was I keep remembering some real big dust-ups, and they've all sort of merged into one in my mind. But I think the best one was probably Wally and
MG,
as they were walking off.
My favourite Origin moment, David Manson in between them. That is still my favourite Origin game, Paul. When Mick O'Connor kicked one from the sideline, Mark McGaw scored a try out wide. Was a cranky, and there was some great, like MG's remember for that fight with Wally. What's not shown is MG launching an elbow at Steve Walters' head, and almost sending you back to Townsville in about 1980. It was that big. It was huge. What about you, Blake? What's your first Origin memories?
Mine are all sad, being a New South Wales fan. Mark Coyne's try, one of the greatest Origin tries, goes from the left side of the field. Mark Coyne scoops under, scores in the corner, the right side. I was actually ball boy for the game where Gordy had the sign.
Oh, yeah.
I was a New South Wales ball boy that game.
Wow.
Hand Lottie the kicking tee. When he was going for goal after Dane Carlaw scored that try in front of the sign, and Gordy gave the
That's right.
So there are a couple of good memories there, but mostly all Queensland. I'd love to celebrate some New South Wales wins.
So what happened? He missed a kick, didn't he?
He did, Lottie. Yes,
and it was a draw. Yeah, okay.
But they won the series, all right?
Yeah.
So I held the trophy. Yeah,
they did.
Did you give him the right tee?
I think I did. Yeah, I shouldn't have. That was my downfall.
When you were playing with him at the Tigers, did you remind him of that?
I did, after a few sherbets one night. Yeah, got some courage up and said, "I was actually a ball boy, mate." Yeah, so showing your age, Lottie. Come back to play.
What about on the playing front, Blake? Were you ever hold out many hopes? When you're peaking, you would have got reasonably close when you were at the Tigers.
I sort of ruined myself. I was on a couple of those New South Wales. I was in the first one. The emerging Blues. The first time they did it when Ricky was there, and there was about 80 of us. And then the next year we got called back, and there was about 20 of us. But we got told not to go out and have some beers and things. And
here we go.
Yeah, well, 2 years in a row, I think I was there and disobeyed orders, and I wasn't the only one, but yeah, it sort of ruined me chances, but so did me footy. But yeah, I did get close there a bit.
Hold on, Ricky Stewart wouldn't hold a grudge.
Not Ricky's go. Is he speaking to you yet?
Oh, mate, no.
I don't want you to throw anyone under the bus from going out, but like just generally speaking, who were the
players
emerging that you were knocking around with in the training?
So the first year we had sort of the likes of Dugan and players like that. And the second year, obviously, I was rooming with Jimmy Maloney.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
So, he's
– No wonder you went out.
Yeah. Yeah, I was in bed before Jimmy, but Jimmy still
– Most people were, I'd say. Yeah. He's brainy it this year at Catalan. I thought he went over last year in particular. I know it was a COVID year, but I thought he was just the retirement fund. But he is killing it. They're playing really good footy. I think they'll finish in the
beat Saints, didn't they, a couple of
weeks ago? Yeah, beat Saints and then flogged Wigan 46-0 or something like that the week after. So
unbeaten Wigan until then.
Before that, yeah. And, I expect them to figure. I think they're probably St. Helens' biggest threat this year.
Well, he is one of the only players to come from the Storm and actually improve his career.
Good point. Yeah.
Yeah.
Good Orange boy born and bred down here as well. So, local hero around here, being the Orange Sporting Hall of Fame with some greats like Paul Dunn.
Let's do New Zealand podcast. Tell us, but you bloody Aussies trying to hijack me.
Oh, sorry, only three Aussies on the podcast. Well, three Aussies in the Cook Island. Boys, Origin 1, let's go through a few of the things before we get to our things. Game moved to Townsville, Fisky, from the MCG. Huge move. The last seven non-neutral venue games have gone to home teams. Got to favour Queensland, doesn't it? This move, you can't see any way that this kind of washes out as kind of even a playing room, CJ.
The only way there'd be some advantage is just that, like you on the paddock might suit the Queensland style. I think the flat track of Townsville and might suit New South Wales point scoring ability. But apart from that, that is one facet that may favour New South Wales. Everything else favours Queensland. Like, normally speaking, a Lang Park home game will still have a good 5,000 to 10,000 Blues fans. There'll be none. There'll be a grand total of about 20 people brave enough to wear a Blues shirt up there.
And you know what? If they do, there'll be 20 bodies buried at the old Dairy Farmers Stadium afterwards, because it is going to be a scary, scary venue if you're a New South Wales fan. How about some of the pre-match entertainment? The pre-game entertainment, Paul, we've seen Tina Turner impersonator setting fire to the team hotel. We've seen stilts and baton twirlers. What year is it in Townsville?
Fisky was telling me just before that they refer to Townsville as the land that time forgot. I'm not sure how it's going to go. I mean, the Tina Turner fireworks is just so rugby league; it's ridiculous. I guess it doesn't really matter what sort of pre-match entertainment they have. The big game will be what everyone's talking about later on. And as Fisky said, I'm guessing this is probably the second worst Queensland team ever put together after last year's one. So.
You hear this a lot, Paul, about the worst Queensland team. But I'm going to say this is a fair upgrade on the side that won Game 3 last year, this Queensland side. So we'll get on team selections soon. Memories of Townsville, Blake. How do you think it plays out from kind of, obviously you never played on the Queensland Country Bank Stadium, but I'm going to take from that smirk. There was a few good nights out afterwards.
Yeah. Memories of Townsville. I just instantly went to the Mad Cow. Sorry, mate.
why does everyone, from Ben Eichen to you, Memories of Townsville is the Mad Cow.
Yeah. Oh, mate, we had some good years up there with the Tigers. And like Fisky said, the dew, no matter, it's just going to be humid, wet, sweaty. I think going to be a slippery ball.
How's that play at the footy sense, Blake? Where you kind of get those humid conditions? Does this suit kind of defensive oriented teams? Does it suit more open to attack because there's no dew there? Or how do you see that kind of play out from a footy perspective?
I reckon a more defensive side. I think you get hit under the ball, great contact, which New South Wales do have with Jake Trbojevic. Ball be slippery, hit him in the right space and the ball pop free. I mean, we'll still see some expansive footy because, like you said, we'll look in the teams in a minute, but the back line for New South Wales and the players on both sides across the park, I think they'd be stupid not to play footy.
Team selections, Bisc. Let's start with New South Wales. They've got, I think, seven changes. They've brought in a host of Panthers players, seven Panther players, three debutants, Jerome Luai, Liam Martin, Brian Tour. What do you like about this New South Wales side and what do you not like?
Well, the back five in particular, I love. I think
happy with them playing both centers out of position?
Look, it's not ideal, but I just don't think they could have gone any other way. I get it, and I'm probably one of the guys that says you don't just always fit the best 13 into your starting lineup. But on this occasion, Latrell and Tom are so good, in particular Tommy T.
Latrell has a long history of playing in the centres too.
That's right. He scored, you know, winning grand final try in the centres. So I think I got no problem with the selection there. I think Cleary's in rare form. So the back line itself is, I wouldn't say least worried about the back line. I think they're a top side, and if they get enough ball and they're coached reasonably well to take advantage of that, I think they'll do really well. My concern sits around the edges, you know, what kind of punch they'll have around the edges, and I don't think Cook's in great form, so it's more the getting on the front foot in attack that worries me a little bit, and just Brad Fittler tactically against Paul Green. I think that's where brings Queensland right into the contest. But overall, pretty good-looking Blues side. Love the back line. I give the forwards just a pass.
Yeah, I think that's a concern. Paul, I wanted to ask you about Jake Trbojevic at prop. Do you like it? Do you not like it? Prop is one area that New South Wales is pretty strong on, so it's surprising that we are playing a lock forward. I know middle's a middle, but he's pretty undersized compared to a prop. I'm not sure he's been that mobile this year. Fairly leading question. I'm obviously pretty opposed to the Trbojevic prop, but where do you stand up?
Oh, I think he's very, very lucky to be selected in the 17. I thought he would have been stretching to make it onto the bench. But he has it. His game has improved over the last 3 or 4 weeks. In fact, it's probably coincided with the return of his brother. His form has sort of stepped up a wee bit, and I guess it's a wee bit easier when Tommy Turbo's making big yards from the back to give the forward pack a wee bit of a sort of a boost. There's any number of New South Wales prop forwards who can look at that and think, geez, I've been hard done by. How could I not get in there?
You can make an argument. Sorry to chime in again. You can make an argument man to man from number 8 to 13 in the pack. You can say Queensland are better in almost every position.
And I don't disagree with that at all. I think that's a huge advantage.
I was just going to say that. I said I think it's plain and simple. I think New South Wales by far have the best back line. It's way superior. And then Queensland have the better forward pack. So it just depends, I suppose, the impact they get from both benches, who can keep that up. Because I think, like I said, the forwards for Queensland will do a job, but I think a lot rests on Brian To'o and Ado Carr coming from the back and taking those early hit-ups, whether we can get started.
Yep, I agree with that. I also think where the fulcrum in this match will swing, I completely agree with all that assessment. I think that Queensland will dominate the forwards. They'll try and play it tight. The Blues will try and play a more expensive game, get their backs more heavily involved. I think this is really going to swing on the two halves pairings. You know, I think Cherry Evans and Munster will play a pretty conservative game, run the ball a lot, kicking the corners. And it's what New South Wales can do. This is where I would ask you, Blake. Nathan Cleary, obviously in great form, leading the Dalian medal, is absolutely flying. Jerome Luai having a very good season as well. Is he the right kind of player for Origin, or is this one of those kind of, you know, one of those kind of fly-by-night players that needs space, needs a dominant pack to really excel in? Or can he thrive in a tight and tough contest like Origin?
I think he can, mate. I mean, you know, everyone was doubting Cleary after the first game last year, and he's probably the best player in the world at the moment. I think what they've got to do is they've got to keep their same game that they play at club into Origin. And what I mean by that is not sort of as free flowing, but they can't go into a shell and just think, oh, this is Origin. We have to play hit up, kick. They have to keep joining, linking with each other, linking with Isaiah Yeo in the middle. And hopefully that's why they got Trbojevic there, to be another ball player in that middle and link. So I think he can thrive, mate. I think they'll do a good job.
Yep, I think that's the fact. I reckon that's the real key to this one. The other key I'm saying, we'll get to the Queensland in a minute, is you mentioned earlier, Fiske, coaching. I know Brad Fittler has the experience. He's coached three series. He won his first two. Notable that those two were against Kevin Walters. Paul Green is technically a very, very astute coach. This might be his Origin debut, but it's hard not to say, Fiske, that the Maroons have a huge tactical advantage during the game on.
Yeah, I'm not wrong in saying he's still been involved in Queensland camps before, Paul Green, for many years. And I think last year was probably the biggest knockout coaching punch I've seen in Origin for many years. I thought Wayne Bennett just pulled the wool over Fittler's eyes. Paul Green would have seen it. The things we're talking about, I've got no doubt Paul Green's aware of. To be fair to Freddie, he's probably aware of some of those deficiencies. Tactically, we probably know how Queensland will play it. I think they'll be the far smarter of the side. I think they've got two of the best halves going around and know how to get the best out of their team and know the weaknesses in New South Wales. I don't know if New South Wales will have the discipline for 80 minutes to continue to do what they're meant to be doing.
I think Freddie really got found out last year.
Yeah, he did.
I think he was really exposed with some of his bench rotations. I think he was... Yeah, I'm not sure that the halves last year was sent out with the clearest of messages, but I think it's going to be very, very clear for Queensland. Like, you're going to rely on your pack, you're going to slow the game down, you're going to make this an arm wrestle, you're going to kick to the corners and make them ruck it out, and take advantage of your opportunities. And I don't know if there's been a half in the comp taking advantage of opportunities more than Cameron Munster, is there?
Yeah, I love that part of their side, and I just... Yeah, it just worries me. I've talked about the edges, and I know Murray's better as a 13, in my opinion.
Yeah.
And Tariq Sims, I don't think he should be there. Talking about
Tariq Sims is very good in New South Wales Cup.
Yeah,
I'm not sure about that. I think I made a mistake because it's New South Wales Origin, not New South Wales Cup.
Field ball's at the line with a greasy ball. What price is he to drop one or two? He'd be very short.
Not sure if you play with the great Ben Pomeroy, Blake Ayshford, but it seems like Ben Pomeroy has been giving some handling advice to Tariq Sims over the years.
Oh, shit. I'm going to stay out of that one.
Stay out of that one, mate. I'll be invited. Well, one thing we haven't mentioned, and I hate to do it because I don't think they go into games to influence it, but the referees will have a huge say.
Yep.
And I have no idea how they will referee it. So I can't even say what I think. I've gut feel. I think he'll put the whistle in the pocket.
They always do, Fissy. They always do. I think. Yeah. I think we'll see early on. You know, laying the law down a bit. I think we will see some penalties. I'd be stunned if we see a sin bin.
Yeah, I think a lot will be put on report. There'll be no sin binning at all because that'll just ruin the game. I think, like you just said, Teddy, the first 10 to 20 minutes, I think the players will be testing the ref out a bit. They'll be told to by the coaches, and then they'll sort of get the gist of it from there. But I don't think any sin bins will happen unless it's very blatant.
I would love to see this game, refereed in a common sense manner. I'm not sure it will be, but what I think will definitely happen is, like we see every NRL game, there will be a glut of six again penalties in the first set restarts in the first 15, 20 minutes, and then we will see nothing after that, is how I see this playing out. And unless there's a clear high shot, and to be fair, it is a clear, obvious high shot that should have been sent to the bin 3 years ago that wasn't, I'm hoping for them to go to the bin. If there's an aggressive shot that is clearly, everyone goes, oh, it's an accident. No one in rugby league goes to hit someone else in the head, I don't think. Right? This is not 1984. You still can get penalised for a reckless shot, a high shot. I've got no problem with it. But if it wasn't someone falling, it was a pretty clear, aggressive one. Like Jack Hetherington should have been dismissed a couple of weeks ago against Canterbury. I have no problem with it. What I don't want to see is these Tyrone Peachy, Dane Laurie laying down all that kind of stuff, and winning penalties that way. That's what I'm hoping is to be avoided.
Yeah, I love the gamesmanship from both sides, saying we're not going to go down injured as long as you don't.
And no milking.
Yeah, it's almost trying to convince the other side not to do it, but then you just do what you want on the day. Straight out of Bullfrog Moore's playbook, Teddy.
One of the great stories, maybe that's one, mate. But when Steve Price was the hottest young kid in rugby league in the early 90s, Manly were chasing him, and the Roosters were chasing him, and Power were chasing him. So Bullfrog Moore goes, boys, we've got to figure this out. We can't be paying overs for this guy. Let's just reach an agreement. Everyone come out to Canterbury Leagues Cup. We'll have a feed at the Chinese restaurant, and we'll sort it out. So Ken Arthurson rocks up. Yeah, Dennis Fitzgerald rocks up. They all rock up. Where's Bullfrog? Bullfrog's up in Queensland. Sorry, Steve Price.
He got his man.
They sorted out all right.
Be careful of gentlemen's agreements in rugby league.
Be very careful. Just want a quick look at the Queensland team before we get into the match itself. Obviously, the weakness, Paul, the back five for Queensland. Looks like Val Holmes will play fullback, which is a bit of a surprise.
On the side, Ted.
Yeah.
An hour before kickoff, maybe it's a disgrace. Absolute disgrace. Name your side.
I guess one aspect where they do have an advantage over New South Wales in the back line is the height of their wingers, Xavier Coates and Kyle Felt versus Brian To'o.
That's a particular way for To'o, isn't it? Like if Queensland are smart, they're bombing him in every attacking position. Because I think Blake might be able to kind of point this in the right direction. I think Coates will mark up on To'o, won't he?
Yeah, I'd say so. They're both – all four wingers are right side. I know, the Fox left, but most of the – no, they're all –
They're left,
and then the Queensland wingers are right wingers, aren't they?
Yeah.
So, I mean, I suppose Coates would. It'd be ideal, but whoever gets, like, even both wingers, I think Felt out jumps the Fox as well.
Yep.
The day of the week, especially in Townsville where he loves it up there, if Felt is in. Yeah, man, I think Coates will be on Brian To'o.
Yeah. If there's one thing that the Queensland team has been practicing all week, it's bombs from DCE or Munster into the corner for either Coates or Felt.
DCE puts up as good a bomb as anyone in the comp as well.
So, Ted, tell me, this Dane Gagai injury scare or sickness scare, is this part of the Maroons playbook?
This is classic Maroons playbook. This is absolutely classic Maroons playbook. To be honest, it wouldn't be Origin without one of these studs. And every New South Wales fan knows it. Every Queensland fan knows they're taking it. It's part of the theatrics, part of the drama of Origin. Dave Gagai will probably wheel him in a wheelchair.
And then man of the match from the centres as normal.
Absolutely. Dane Gagai, if South's got the same amount of Dane Gagai as Queensland did, South's had about seven premierships right now. Unbelievable. Blake, Harry Grant looks like he's going to play 80 minutes. How do you think he's going to go? He hasn't played a lot of football.
I know. I mean, he's world-class to me. He's
got all the skills, no doubt about that.
Yeah, he's a great footy player. I think if Brimson's out, they bring Ben Hunt on the bench, and I think they would try and give Harry Grant maybe 10 to 15. But that's just, you know, that's trying to predict the future. But I think Harry will go good at for 80 minutes. I mean, if Damian Cook can do it, I believe Harry Grant can. I mean, it's Origin. You don't, you know, you won't say no to it. And like we've already spoken about, their forward pack's a lot better, we think, than the New South Wales one. I think he's got some good boys around him.
Much better, I agree. And I think the other thing that will suit Harry, they're a decidedly more aggressive pack than New South Wales. So you see, you get some real mongrel with a Christian Welsh, but you get some, like, the big hitters like Fafita and Big Tino.
Joy Arrow hit too.
And Joy Arrow likes the dicey, which I love as well. New South Wales, they're kind of a, you know, plotting's probably the wrong word, but they're not. You wouldn't call the likes of Cameron Murray, Jake Trbojevic really aggressive. Like, I know Tariq Sims is, but of that pack, there's not a lot of aggression in it.
I think it's a pack of athletes for the Blues. They're fit and generally decent leg speed, but Queensland are a traditional pack. Like, they hunt as a pack. I love Christian Welsh offload. He's a smart footballer.
Oh, I love Christian Welsh, full stop. He's a great footballer.
He's going really well. And I think I mentioned it last podcast, I think Felice Kaufusi's having his best year in the NRL. He's just doing everything right. And then you've got your impact players like your Arrows, Fafitas, so, and even Fodawaker off the bench. These guys can hit and stick. The only player I would put in that conversation for the Blues is Lee Martin. I love him as a footballer. He's quick and he's hard, but he's just, you know, he's from the bush. And I love the way he plays footy. I think he's going really well. Maybe Junior Paulo too. I think he's having a very good year.
And yeah, I think he's good. I'm not sure Junior Paulo's super aggressive, but I think he's definitely got in him as well. Yeah. I want to see the Junior Paulo that smashes people, not the Junior Paulo that likes to play cute and with the offloads in it.
That's right. And that's where occasionally a Payne Haas is not suited to these games. His strength's his motor, but when you've got him off the bench playing 35 minutes, like, what's he add?
So,
Dale Finucan or Regan Campbell-Gillard, you could give him a specific task and they'll go and do it.
Right. Okay, we're going to go around the room here. We're going to do our origin tips. What we're going to do, we're going to do a best bet. We're going to do a total. We're going to do a same game multi. We're going to do a man of the match. We're going to do an anytime try score. I'm not throwing you on the spot there, but we just really got over the multi.
This is going to take 45 minutes.
So get going. So best bet. We'll start with you. We'll start with you, Fisky. What do you got?
Thanks, Ted. I think from what we've all just said, most of us, I don't want to speak for anyone else, it's just nothing in this. We just don't know. Is it going to be a game that the backs will dominate, in which case New South Wales do well? Is it going to be tight and lower scoring, in that case probably Queensland? So therefore, I just think it's close to a pick game. So if you're getting a 4.5 start in an origin, especially game one, I'll take it every day of the week. So my best bet is Queensland plus $4.50. Not declaring it, but I just couldn't be on anything else.
Paul?
Mark me down for two. I'll have that as well. I think the two sides sort of cancel each other out. There won't be too much in it. So Queensland plus 4.5, I think. It's almost a gift.
Blake?
Yep. My best bet is the boys have just touched on a close game. I've got New South Wales 1-12. I just think I can't see New South Wales winning by a bigger margin than 12. And I think they've just got the team to do it and they have to do it. So, I think they get up 1-12.
$3.
$3. Seven of the last 9 series openers have been decided by a single-digit margin. 5 of the last 7 by 4 points or fewer. The last 10 series openers, we haven't seen more than 34 points scored in it. They're usually tight, usually low scoring, really feel each other out, these series openers. I'm on Queensland plus 4.5, I think. It's an absolute gift as you so eloquently put it, Fisky, so I'll be joining you on that one. I think this will be a real close one.
As a rugby league purist, and I think we can all agree that it's a great start to a series, like a new ground. It's exciting for the locals, and you just can't pick a winner. If anyone declares anyone, they're kidding themselves. I think it's just who knows, who knows.
Total, Fisky. Nothing I can say, a total eclipse of the
heart. Yeah, I've
big number. It's a big number, 42.5.
I've tried to make an argument for the overs, and it's been an over season. I've been on the most weeks. I'm going to take the under. I just think, like you say, the first 15 and 20, and then it might just regress to just origin and let the players sort it out without a lot of confidence because it is a different year and things are just strange, things are happening. So I'm going to take the under 42.5. Historically, it's a tremendous bet. Like you say, last 10 openers, Ted?
Yep, last 10
openers. No more than 34 points. So historically, it's a tremendous bet. Different world and everything, but I'm still going to have that under 42.5.
Paul?
Yeah, am I missing something here? 42.5.
I can't think of a total that's been this high in Origin in a decade.
I had a look back as well. The last 5 games, the last 5 game ones, have had no more than 34 points.
The last 10.
Is that right?
Keep going back for last 10.
Keep going.
So last six as well, and last seven, I guess.
Yeah. Eight.
Last eight. Yeah. Sorry. This will take 45 minutes.
Yeah. Me and Fisky, we're singing from the same hymn sheet. Oh, I think it's another gift. There's two gifts, the plus 4.5 and the under 42.5.
Blake, same thing.
Give me a look at that hymn sheet because I'm jumping on, mate. 42.5.
Woo!
Yeah, well, we've got ourselves a choir because I'm into under 42.5. That is, it was in lately, like as the crackdown has weakened off a little bit. Like, I wouldn't say it's stopped, but they've certainly taken a back seat over the last week and a half, or the last 2 weeks, but the last 12 games. Well, we've seen some lower scoring games. It's definitely possible. So,
definitely got someone's ear.
Yeah, but no risk at all. So more than happy for the under that one. Looking for a roughy, were we? Is that what we said now?
I don't know.
Roughy, what are you up for a roughy? Oh, I'll kick us off. I'm going to go Queensland. So, Queensland 240 for me is the roughy.
Yeah, thanks. It'd be harder for me to go against that, and I'm going to follow in. Queensland, roughy, 240. I'm going to take that.
Paul?
What other bets are we doing after the roughy? Because
we're doing a same game multi.
Okay. I might do a power play instead of the – which is sort of a same game multi in and itself.
Yeah.
So for my roughy, I'm sort of going with you guys. I'm going to go Queensland 1-12 at $3.40.
Yep. I'll go with you, Paulie. I'll hedge me bets. Queensland 1-12, roughy.
Love it.
And what are we up to now? We're up to anytime try scorer. Anytime try scorer, number one, our same game loss at the end. So, have you got any time try scorer for us? Yeah, you like the look of.
This is a try time game.
Try time game.
Don't forget, place a pre-match $30 or more anytime try scorer bet, and you'll get a $5 bonus bet for every try scored in this match.
I think Teddy said it before. These games seem to have a high propensity of centres and wingers scoring outside backs, just because the defences are so good. They really have to work hard to find space. And on that note, I just have to take him. He lifts every time. I'm going to go Gagai at $2.63.
Interesting, Fisky. You go, Paul, but just a Dane Gagai breakdown. I think he scored all of his tries on a wing.
On the wing.
Level. I don't think he scored a try at centre.
Would have had a few.
He's played four centre, hasn't scored a try. 13 tries and 14 appearances on the wing for Queensland.
Okay. I'm going to rescue you, so we'll see how it goes.
Paul? I'm going to go a wee bit leery. And because this guy is probably going to be playing close to 80 minutes, and I can see that New South Wales pack tiring late in the game.
Well, I like where you're headed with this one, Paul.
Like Harry Grant to just dart out of dummy half and under the clutches of Jake Trbojevic, to score next to the post in the 72nd minute. So Harry Grant to score a try. He's paying $6 to score a try.
If Jake Trbojevic is playing in the 72nd minute, Brad Fittler has done something severely wrong. very, very nice. What about you, Blake?
Oh, mate, I can't go past the Fox. I know he's only $1.72, but I think it's easy money, even though nothing ever is. I think he's 9 appearances or 8 appearances for 8 tries. I've visualised this in my head. Teddy cut out pass to him. No one's catching him. Latrell fend off 3 people, flick pass. I think he's even good for a couple. So anytime trial scorer, I'll go on the Fox.
I know I'm a good podcast host, Blake, but I don't know how good my cutout ball is, so I'm not sure I'm going to find Latrell out there. Look, I think Xavier Coates is a good thing to score a try, but I'm not going to take the $2. I'll throw him in the same game multi. But I'm going to go with Cameron Munster at $4.20. I just absolutely love him in the Origin arena. He's only scored the one try in 10 Origin appearances and comes off an injury. But I can see this is a game where he'll be just running angles. He's got a lot of Wally Lewis about him, if you ask me, Cameron Munster. So I'll be on Munster at $4.20. Same game multis. Throwing down the bus here, Fisk, but what do you got for us?
Yeah, so we talked about it. Jeez, lost my voice there. Sound like a school kid. Talk about the old Wellington Boys Choir. We're singing from a pretty similar hymn sheet on the under. So I'm going to throw that in my same game multi, under 43.5. And I like Queensland Plus. I believe with our same game multi, it's plus 5.5. And, yeah, I'm going to get in trouble for this, but I'm going to take him anyway. Gagai, anytime try scorer. So basically all the three I've said. So Gagai to score a try, game to go under 43 in Queensland plus 5.5, comes out at $7.
Yep, very nice. Paul?
Was that was $7 for that one?
Yep.
Okay, I'm going to take a power play and check them out because there are a whole bunch of them for punters to get stuck into. I'm sort of heading down the same pathway as Fisky. I'm going to take Dane Gagai to score the first, second, or third try and Queensland to win 1-12. That's paying $10.
Very nice. Blake?
Good money there. Yeah,
I'm on a power play as well. And I've gone Teddy, first, second, or third try scorer in New South Wales, 1-20. Now, that's a massive money. It's $4.50. But you'd think if New South Wales win, they're not winning by more than 20.
You wouldn't have thought so. Not up there.
I think you'll do a good job up the middle, mate. Support play.
Yeah, I'm always willing to back up. I'm going to go on a similar path for you. If you see Queensland, I'm taking plus 7.5, give them a little extra there. Under 43.5 total points. Cameron Munster to score a try. Xavier Coates to score a try. $21.
Not bad, Ted. Nice. You'll be up and about if that gets.
I'll tell you what, after the weekend, fellas, it is desperation.
Who'd you have scoring a try, Teddy?
Xavier Coates and Cameron Munster.
Coates and Munster.
Origin. No official bets here. I don't think we have the market up, but man of the match, quickly around the ground before we get to NRL round 14. Fisky, man of the match.
I'll go with a Queensland player, as I've been leaning that way. I'd like to see Harry Grant get it. I think they'll go a more experienced player, and Munster is no bigger big match player than Cameron Munster, I think. I think he will be the fulcrum that the side will revolve around. I think he'll have a blinder.
Not only do I not believe Cameron Munster has a foot injury, as Queensland like to be saying, I'm not even convinced Cameron Munster has a foot. Queensland is so full of lies, so it wouldn't surprise me what's going on up there. Paul?
Harry Grant for mine. I think he's going to go huge, and he's going to get plenty of minutes. He'll be tackling everything that moves, but he'll make a couple of decisions in that match which will turn it in Queensland's favour. So Harry Grant at 12.
What about you, Blake?
For me, sticking to New South Wales, I think Cleary's got to get it. I mean, he's going to control this game. With his kicking game. We spoke about how good the forward pack is for Queensland, and if you can kick into a corner and get those Queensland backs to run it out, I think New South Wales will go on the way to win. So I think Cleary, with his kicking game, gets it.
The favourite at $6.
I'm going with Cameron Munster.
For the record, it is $8, Munster.
$8?
Yeah.
With us?
Yeah.
Yeah.
There isn't anyone else, Ted.
Of course not. All right, Origin, enjoy Origin, team. But of course, we return to regular season rugby league next weekend, starting on Friday. 8 games, Friday through Monday. the Australian Queen's birthday long weekend. Let's just do a few bits and bobs around the grounds before we get into it. Another big story coming out of Canberra this week. Curtis Scott looks like he will spend some time on the sidelines, involved in a pub blue. The question to you, Blake, is, yeah, you obviously don't want to drink. How have you managed to avoid this trouble throughout your entire career?
I was never much of a fighter, so that was one. But I just don't know why you do it. Like, if you can't handle it, just get off the drink. You've got too much to risk.
You're talking to me, or
you're well behaved, Blake. You're well behaved, mate. Just walk away. I mean, it's quite simple. They're you're given that much money. I don't know how players keep getting in trouble with it. So, yeah, like I said, I wasn't a fighter, so I never had to deal with it. I was easy to walk away, but obviously Curtis Scott fancies himself when he has a couple of beers.
So you would have been out with, say, Benj at the top of his peak, right? Every kid wanted to be him, and then all the young kids that were out and about that are over 18 wanted to probably chat to him, and then you're out having drinks. How did he handle it?
He was good, man. Like, I suppose, you know, all the bouncers and that, the security when we used to go out, would get him in and would secure an area for him. So it was obviously well looked after there.
Yeah.
But he'd take his photos, do what he'd have to do, you know, and then just move on.
Yeah.
And you can sort of tell if there was a pest that kept talking to him, then one of the boys would step in. And but it was never him.
So
that
you
would
have
do
met
it.
Mawadi before. But yeah, so for Benji, all the credit, all the years he's been, and Benji's a traditional footballer, likes going out, and he's a good bloke. He's never gotten too many dramas, so credit to Benji. You can be done. That's what I'm trying to say, Ted.
I was wondering where you was. Very good. A player we may never see in first grade again after he one of the great disasters was Paul Carriages on Friday night, just Jermaine Osaka, so Thursday night. That has got to be up there. I remember a game Manu Vakavai had against Parramatta that was an absolute shock. Paul Carriage, the famous Greg Smith game. Do you remember Greg Smith's performance, Blake? He was the supposed NFL player that Warren Ryan brought across to the Newcastle. Never played a game of NFL in his life. fooled everybody. And Daryl Halligan ran rings around him. That's how good he was. This was up there with one of those performances. It was an absolute. What was he doing before halftime?
Oh, he just. There's only 15 seconds left. You kick it dead, because it doesn't matter. You don't have to do a line dropout. He just watched the ball and let Dufty have his own way with it, and that's unforgivable. Because that's just, you work so hard to protect your line and then give up a try like that.
Corey Norman, not really known for his rugby league smarts. But I will say this, they must have had something with Osaka for that, because they've kicked to that exact position for that exact reason. Like, it wasn't on, like, Osaka was in position. Like, this wasn't like everyone's in the line, we'll just kick over the top or something on here. It was just like, we're going to kick towards Osaka, hoping there's something stupid.
Yeah, he was back there. He had plenty of time as well.
It's the law of the jungle, though, Blake, isn't it? When you spot an opposing player down in confidence, everyone picks up on it.
Straight after him. Yeah, but the thing is, Teddy said he'd never play NRL again. I think there's rumours maybe the Bulldogs, the blue and white.
He really fits the Bulldogs' mould of being an incompetent winger who's been pushed into a fullback role that he's not suited to. I'm surprised we haven't offered him $1.7, $1.8 million a season. There was a little rumour that we were after Dufty, but he was too good, so we've passed him off and we'll go after Osaka. On the flip side of Osaka, probably being dropped for this weekend, Paul Carmichael Hupp, looks like he might be playing his first NRL game in 12 years this week.
Yeah, well, I guess, crikey. If you've got a pair of boots and you live in Brisbane somewhere, you're probably a chance of turning out for the Broncos at some stage this season. If I was Blake, I'd be walking around, walking past Suncorp or somewhere with my boots over my shoulders. You'd be called in.
I'll tell you what, if Blake Ayshford right now isn't better than the entire three-quarter line of the Broncos this week, I will eat my hat. Absolutely no risk. What do you want to play, Blake? Fullback, center, wing? Do you miss?
You get some backlash for that comment. I actually like the move, and this is why. Because I wouldn't Hunt, like, he's not going to be there in the future. All right, let's be honest. He's maybe got this year left. I would hate to chuck a young kid who we're developing into this Broncos team right now. Look what's happened to Tommy Dearden. Now, if you chuck a young kid into this side and they get beat to Canberra by 30, it can. We just spoke about confidence. Kid's gone. You can ruin a kid's career like that. So I don't mind the move as in resting or leaving our developed players out and chucking Carmichael in.
I think where your argument falls apart, Blake, is you're assuming Kevin Walters is developing players. I'm not confident that is correct.
they ship young players out. One went to the Roosters, one went to the Warriors.
Yeah. I know, exactly right. Reece Walsh couldn't find a spot for him at the Broncos. It's going to go right now.
So I know the size getting named in a couple of hours. So we're saying Tyson Gamble with Carmichael to the partnership. Yep.
Katoni Staggs is back. I think Katoni Staggs is back, and they want him as a six.
Okay.
But there's a lot of things, because Herbie Farnworth was at the back when Asako got dropped, so it could be Herbie Farnworth before. But there's a lot of things that can happen there.
I'll tell you what, there's nothing more entertaining than the Broncos team list on a Tuesday. Really, anything can happen. Literally anything can happen. I remember having a chat pre-season with Eichen talking about Tommy Dearden, thinking like he was a mole to start as the halfback. He goes, I think Kev's off him. He goes, I think they're going to start out with Kelly. Oh, and we all just laughed, like, surely they couldn't start out with Kelly. Well, here we are, as a potential Albert Kelly Carmichael half pairing, which is next level.
And we're talking NRL, not Queensland Cup.
Oh, so good. A few rumours going around, Fisky. Around the halves, Mitchell Pearce to the Sharks. Any truth on that one?
I don't know. I haven't heard it. But you always get some good mail, Ted. But
this
time of the year, this at the moment with all the halves on the move and a lot of money being thrown around, the player agent just loving life. So they're dropping these little rumours in left, right, and centre.
Well, there's a lot of rumours and there's just stuff James Hooper makes up. So it's hard to differentiate the two, but this might be in the latter.
You'd think Fitzgibbon played with Piercy, coached him for a bit, maybe.
I would have thought that would have been the actual one reason that the rumour would be false. Fitzgibbon played with him, surely why does he bring him into the side?
And I thought it was interesting last week. I know they've got a plan. I like the fact they know what they're doing. But Sean Johnson off the radar. They don't want him. I found that interesting.
Yeah, what do you make of that, Blake? They've kind of tossed up between Johnson and Moylan to join Nico Hines and the halves at the Sharks, and they seem to have plucked on Warner, which I found very strange.
I found it strange too. I mean, we've got Nico Hines 600K, Chad Townsend not playing for it's 800K. I mean, that's another story in itself. But that's why I think the rumours about Piercy could be true, because I can't see Moylan partnering Nico Hines. Could any of you use? Like, I don't think it makes sense.
No, there's no traditional game manager. So maybe the Pierce one has legs. They've got a plan. They know they're getting him. And Moylan will probably fall by the wayside or be a backup utility. And maybe they've all along they've had Pierce in their sights and he's ready to go. Who knows?
And where does Johnson look?
They said the Bunnies lately, haven't they? So,
yeah, that's a rumour going around.
If I'm sticky right now, I get Johnson straight away and try and salvage whatever we can for the rest of the year.
Because I think my last dollar, Luke Brooks will be the halfback at the Raiders next year.
Oh, yep. Oh, the way he played on the weekend, geez, best game in 24 months. So I'd sign him. But I mean, then if Souths need a halfback and Sean Johnson's available, I mean, at a discounted price, I think behind that forward pack, it'd be good.
I'd love to see him in Canterbury if anyone's listening, but over to Stuart for that. We'll be all in. We'll try and get George Williams back at about $1.9 million a year. fellas, shall we get onto it this week? NRL round 14.
You haven't mentioned the Tigers. I'm outraged, Ted.
The Tigers?
Huge.
And I thought it was wonderful how Luke Brooks went into the Panthers dressing room and helped address the adversity That's they all suffered. Nah, it was a big win by the Tigers. They did manage to beat the Penrith Reserve Grade / Canterbury 2022 first grade side. It's pretty convincingly.
It was a good. I loved it. I thought it was a really good game of footy. It was
did you?
Old school. Yeah, I absolutely loved it, and I made it pretty clear to everyone around me at the.
How many beers deep were you at Leichhardt?
There was a few. No, I didn't go to Leichhardt. I was at Triple H. But I will say, I thought Blake's right. I thought Brooksy had a blind this in and away. He's got now where he's sort of squaring up the line and actually passing the ball.
He's just a better runner. Like when he runs the ball, he's just a much better player, isn't he?
Yeah, and I'm loving. There's one player. I probably haven't had this much affection for a player since Keefe Galloway, but Alex Seyfarth from Tigers, number 13. They'll trouble to unsettle him now. He's just given it his best, and hopefully he keeps up the form because he's not scared of anyone, and he's just what the Tigers needed.
Did you hear the hot mic about what he said to Ville Abikikia?
Yeah, loved it. We can't repeat it, but let's just say he wasn't scared of big Billy.
Well, I'll leave the expletives out. But when a guy has played 5 or 6 first grade games, says, "I'm going to bash you," that's the kind of player I can get behind. So I'm with you, Fizz. Outstanding.
It's exactly what we need. And we kind of showed Kikau up. Now, I don't think you could go with that kind of attention. And you watch what every team does for the rest of the year. I think they'll pick up on that.
Absolute flat track bully.
And there was a bit of flat track bully about Charlie Staines too. He didn't make any ground up on Jacob Little on that 95-meter screen.
Oh. You would not have taken 10-1 about Little when he took off, would you?
None.
Holy moly! It was a poor chase by Charlie Staines.
Yeah, he was perfect.
It's all right. Let's get on to this week's action, and let's start with our best bets for round 14.
So we should probably have a look back at what happened last week, Teddy.
I legit forgot about it, but I'm guessing it wasn't good. So was it minus 500 for me, Paul?
No, you actually got Jesse Arthurs at 360 to score a try.
Oh, something. Something for the
last week. That was your only collect.
Went downhill from there.
Yeah, you were down 300 odd for the week.
Down minus 320 for me, plus 375 from Whitey, plus 270 for the Fist Dog.
We're doing all right.
Yep.
Two out of three ain't bad. To admit,
us Kiwis are doing well, Paul.
Yeah. we read it like a book over here.
You'll need to. Not much else to do over there. All right, best bets for this week. We've got some massive lines this week. We've got a lot of double-digit favourites. I don't think the closest game in betting we have is, do we have anything under a converted try, Fisk?
No, the Canberra-Brisbane 8.5 is the lowest.
Yep, and we've got the Cowboys-Manly 8.5.
Yeah, Cowboys getting 9.5 at Brookie and
Panthers
getting 9.5 at home, Colgrats at Penrith, yeah.
Sweet. All right. Let's get to the best bet. Best bets last week. Fisky did it easy with the Eels and Paul did it easy with the Dragons. By the Storm, minus 22.5. Never apply for it. Fisk.
Yeah, I'm going to take one of the biggest starts this weekend. I'm going to take the New Zealand Warriors, 14.5. And hear me out here. They're playing Melbourne Storm at Gosford. Adam Fanua Blake's back. They're rested, so they're getting close to their full-strength side. Now, we know Reece Walsh is out suspended, but that might suit them for the week. I think they go back to the two traditional halves and Roger at fullback. I don't think it's a bad thing. Storm missing. We don't know how many Origin players will back up for starters. On top of that, I believe Kenny Bromwich suffered an injury. Nelson Asofa Solomona and Remus Smith suspended for a fortnight each. So not only could it be a really weakened Melbourne side if the Origin players don't come back, a couple of injuries and suspensions on top of that. So might be pushing it here to cover the 14.5. So I'm on the Warriors plus.
Paul.
Yeah. Obviously, without knowing who's coming back after Origin makes it a wee bit harder. And I've probably taken the wrong pathway here, but I've taken
still
a
got time to change.
I've taken a match that features two really bad teams, and it's not the last game of the round. It's the Raiders up against the Broncos, and I know the Broncos look terrible last time out, but the Raiders aren't going much better. For mine, there's things going on behind the scenes. Players aren't very, very happy. So I'm going to take the Broncos +8.5 at $1.90. I just think they'll bounce back a bit. They're getting a few players back, hopefully. They'll make a few more changes, as they do every week. But I think they can keep this fairly close. So Broncos +8.5.
I fell into that trap last week, Paul. You're going to regret it.
Yeah, I know. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Papa and even Croker might be back.
Oh, here's a tip: not having Curtis Scott, massive upgrade. Have you seen Curtis Scott defend the last 6 weeks? Massive upgrade.
Only at the pub.
It's Tomoko time. It's Tomoko time. Blake, best for the week.
I've gone for a Sunday game. Fisky's not going to like me going against my Tigers. I just can't see how. I mean, the Tigers' first back-to-back win in a long time. I don't think they go three in a row. Parramatta made some tough calls the other week, dropping some players and look good on the weekend. I think -10.5. They cover that with ease.
No money.
Yeah, we said Joey Lussick, Nathaniel Roach, backup hookers. I think, I think Mitchell Moses will control it against his mate Brooks.
Yeah, I was tossing up between two matches. That was one of them. I've gone the other way. I'm going with South -16.5 against Newcastle. I think Newcastle are absolutely horrid. Beaten 40-4 on Old Boys Day. They've got a bad record wrestling on Old Boys Day as well. They've got some absolute hideys up there. To Parramatta, I don't think Parramatta were good last week. They were solid without being spectacular. I just thought the Knights were horrific. South are exactly the kind of team that worry the Knights. They've covered 12 of the last 17. South have scored 34 or more in 6 of the last 9 against the Knights. They have covered 8 of the last 10, they've scored 38+, which are their last start against the Eels. Newcastle covered just 2 of the last 9 road games, 8 of 23 of conceding more than 16 points. This is a good spot for South cover, and they'll win well with Latrell back or not for me. Let's go with a roughie, Paul. Fisky. Roughie for the win.
We're going to jump straight on the back of you, Ted. And it was between the Warriors or the Rabbitohs for my best bet. So with my roughie of the week, I'm going to take the Rabbitohs at the alternate line. I'm going to take the -28.5 at 340. I won't add anything to your comments about Newcastle being very poor, and I think South will exploit them. So -28.5 at 340.
Paul?
Once again, we're on the same hymn sheet here, Fisky, except I'm reading a different verse. I've got the Rabbitohs at the alternate line as well. I'm taking the -26.5 at $3.
You love prices writing, don't you, Paul? This is the second week in a row I reckon you've done this.
Let's look at the scoreboard.
Not compared to me, Paul. Not compared to me. Blake?
I'm going to go real wide here. And I'm going to go a Dogs upset on Monday.
Ooh, I like where you're coming from.
If Ben Hunt plays Origin, I think Tarek Sims as well. It's just got that feel. Bulldogs love playing those games, and I think it's possible $4.35.
Go the Dogs.
Here if you go. Remember when they played 4 or 5 weeks ago, the Dogs were heavily backed. I think the line came in from 13 into 8, Ted.
Yeah.
And
did fire points, a shot. But
yeah. So they're a lot longer now than they were 4 or 5 weeks ago. So
Dogs come in good. Dogs come in good form. Play. Dogs come in good form. They did sneak home against the bye last week. So 2 points. Two points.
Yeah. Wow.
Love them.
More seriously, they have covered three straight games, the Dogs. So, my roughie, I'm going to go with 61 plus total points in the Manly North Queensland game at $4.50. This is a strong over angle for both teams. Love the overs. The line is 41.5. Absolutely no way it starts there. Manly, 16-4 over the total when they play a Brookvale off a loss. 22-9 that play a bookie full stop. The Cowboys have gone over in 12 or 15 when they've conceded 8 or more points. So I think it'll be an overs game. Not too much of a stretch to get 61 plus points these days with the refereeing as it is. So $4.50 there for me. Total.
Yeah, Gold Coast let me down 2 weeks in a row, so I'm going to steer clear of them. I'm going to steer clear of the overs just for a week. I think there's been a little bit of a softening of the crackdown. You're seeing less and less restarts, and there's two sides that are really battling. And on a cold Saturday night in Canberra, I'm expecting it to be a real grind. And the 49.5 looks too big for mine, so I'm going to take the under 49.5 Canberra v Brisbane. Canberra will just want to win, and I think just like they beat the Dogs, I think it was 20-18, it's not about trying to put on a party, it is just trying to get across the line. So if they do hit a lead, and they'll just do their best to hold on to it, and I think it'll be, turn into a real, real battle late on just to get them across the line without any damage. So under 49.5 at 185.
Yep. I don't mind that at all. Paul?
Yeah, over 49.5 in the Sea Eagles-Cowboys game. First game of the week.
Yep. Okay, nice one. Blake?
Yeah, I'm with you, boys. Over 49 I got down as the Cowboys-Manly game.
Yep, that looks everyone's on the same page there. I'm going to go with, I think it's 50.5 in the Roosters-Gold Coast game. The overs hit 62% when the Titans are off, conceding 20 or more. It's 19-9 when the Roosters are favoured by double digits. So this is a good spot for this game to be plenty of points in this one. So I think the Titans play significantly better football at night than in the daytime. So I think most of the Roosters open them up a little bit here. Multi-anchor, your good thing for the week, boys.
Yeah, before I give that, I just wanted to call out Jaden Campbell for Gold Coast. I thought he was really impressive in his
game. He was very good, wasn't he?
Yeah, I enjoyed him, and I think it wasn't one of those games where things went his way and hard off the ball. I think he'll be a great footballer, so hopefully they find a spot for him this week. Or
he showed a lot of courage as well, I thought. Like, he's a pretty, like, he's 80 kilos really wet. And he was putting his body on the line and going up for him and getting involved and pushing through the line. I love the way he played.
Yeah, I was really impressed. So my multi-anchor this week, I'm not going to get too cheeky. I'm just going to take the South Sydney Rabbitohs at $1.17. That's a silly price.
Paul?
Yeah, I am going a wee bit silly this week with my anchor. I've got the Rabbitohs and the Sea Eagles both to win. It comes in at just under $1.60.
I am getting real silly because I'm a long way behind. I'm going with the Roosters, Rabbits and Panthers at $1.94, three-way multi. What are you, Blake?
Oh, just sticking to the Eels, mate. Like I said, I don't see them getting beat this week. $1.28.
Free money. I think it's going to be a week for favourites. Try time this week, boys. No Thursday game. We are going with the Warriors game on Sunday.
Yes, we are.
Tri-time game. So, live from Gosford, it'll kick off Sunday's pretty good action footy, actually. So, Warriors Storm. So, Bisky, who are you opening us up with on this one?
Yeah, look, I'm going to go my man, Roger. I love him. And I think as proud and as brave he's been this year trying to help Reece into first grade, I think number one's his spot. He knows that. He's an alpha dog in town, and I think he'll show everyone why this weekend. I think he'll get across the line. We don't have the prices up, but that's my try time pick.
The real courage of Roger is having to endure Nathan Brown putting on a wing. Poor Roger. Just get him at fullback and let Reece play in the halves. Paul?
I'm going with the Fox at O'Carr to back up after State of Origin and to score a try.
Blake?
I've gone big Ben Murdoch Masilla.
He's
playing some great footy off the bench.
How good is he going? He's flying.
Mate, he is. He's got a new engine since he's been back from the Super League. And he's crossed quite a few times in these appearances back for the Warriors. So I think he'll get across the line.
Normally you can get him around $4.50. I've been backing him a lot lately. He scored six tries this year. Six tries in 11 games. It's a fair effort for a back row. And in his four starts, he scored three times. So, but he scores off the bench as well. So it's,
where was his junior club, Blake, when he came to Tigers?
So he just came straight from Keebra. Okay. He was brought over to Keebra Park and then, came into the Tigers system.
Yeah, he's one of those players that's getting better with age, clearly. I think he was best player in the field when Tonga beat the Kangaroos 3 years ago.
Yep.
And he's kept that form up.
I love the way he plays. He doesn't try to play 80 minutes and try to make it. He just comes on in bursts. And like, he is super aggressive. He turned the tide in that game. He, when they took Eli Katoa off and they brought Murdoch Masilla on in the game against the Cowboys 2 weeks ago, he was the impetus for that comeback, him and Bunty. So it was a really good – he's a really good player. I like that bet a lot. I'm going with Jerome Hughes. Underrated try scorer for the Storm. Scored five tries in his last eight appearances. Jerome Hughes, usually around a $3.40, $3.50 mark. So be keen on Jerome Hughes. Boys, epic podcast.
Yeah.
Epic podcast.
Huge.
Thoroughly enjoyable. Got Origin Wednesday night, try time there. We've got round 14 coming up. We've got try time on the Warriors Storm. Thanks for joining us, Blake.
Well, just a quick one. Sorry, before I cut you off rudely. Check our Facebook and Twitter sites and the Punters Lounge. We're going to be announcing our NRL
sweepstakes.
Blake will be doing that. So by the time this goes to air, they'll be announced. So watch that. Someone's going to win a $40,000 bonus bet and be a 20. Now, Teddy, are we going to share what they have their bonus bet on?
We are absolutely going to share what they have in their bonus bet on. So the punters will know what everyone's having their bonus bet on. It's going to be epic. So everyone will know the name. And as you watch Origin, you'll be looking for the first try score. I think it's a $40,000 bonus bet. Second, 20. Third, 10. Let me go down from there. Is that right, Blake?
Yep. And everyone who is a winner gets a $500 bonus bet. So
minimum.
Yep. Exactly. You'd be happy with that.
Even if you've got say who's the least likely player? Even if you've got Jaden Sewer, you're still going to get a $500 bonus bet. So
yeah, anything can happen. You come on and get the third try.
I'm going to try it, and then all of a sudden you've got yourself a $10,000 bonus bet, and the pressure that comes with that, the excitement, the thrill, it's going to be absolutely epic. So, but we'll also that during Origin. So, look, if you've got this far, you've listened to this before Origin. If not, well, go congratulate the winner. Thanks for joining us, Blake. Great to have you in the studio.
That's awesome, mate. Good to be here in Wellington. I'm sure we'll enjoy a good Wednesday night.
Thanks, Fisky, for making it across New Zealand.
Thank you.
And thanks, Paul, for managing to roll out of bed and walk six steps to the office. So, well played. Oh, gotcha.
Yep, there's another one for HR.
There's a long, long list, Paul.
The list is growing.
That's right. My popularity with the HR team should help me through. No end. All right, boys. Big week of footy. Enjoy it. We'll catch everyone again next week on The Advantage Line.